Dominic Pettman, I'm the current chair of the Liberal Studies program here at the New School, and we're very pleased to claim Roy as one of our own, as an alum. So I'm going to actually take this captive audience to publicize a brand new program in Liberal Studies, a brand new MA called Creative Publishing and Critical Journalism, headed out by Jim Miller, who was the former chair of Liberal Studies. So we like to think of it as an active, energetic, Ken is also on faculty there, McKenzie Wark, and Anthropocene, and is one of the topics that will show up in the curriculum very soon, whether it's on his syllabi, of course, already. But, so do Google it if you have time to see what we're good at, and attention to writing is a big part of it, where Roy hung his craft. So I'll pass the mic over to Ken, who is moderating today, and to welcome our guests. So thank you.
Thank you, Dominic. And my thanks to Liberal Studies at the New School for Social Research, and Eugene Link, hosts and sponsors here. Where should I begin? I wanted to take the opportunity of Roy coming out, Learning to Die in the Anthropocene. You can get them over there if you want. We have books for sale. Just have a conversation here in the space of the New School about what's theory in the Anthropocene. How we to use spaces of learning and thinking to address a kind of critical agenda. And I thought I would invite Stephanie Wakefield, who, among other things, is a founding member of Woodbine. Just Google Woodbine to find out what they do. Very interesting organization. What I asked my co-panelists to do was to give very, very short 5-minute presentations, and I'll talk for 5 minutes, and then we'll have a conversation and then sort of fold people from the audience into that conversation as well. So that's what we're going to do. So how are we to do theory in the Anthropocene? And you guys want to say Anthropocene or Anthropocene? It's like, where I come from, you'd say Anthropocene, but American English, it doesn't quite roll that way. So say it however you like. So how are we to do theory in the Anthropocene? We run out of time for arguments. It's time, really, to compare notes on how we might live. And to that end, I thought it would be useful to bring together two writers whose approach is quite different to mine, as well as to each other, Roy Scranton and Stephanie Wakefield. And what they have in common is that they get it. They get it that one cannot really pretend that life just goes on as if everything was normal, and theory cannot go on as if the world would leave it alone. So I want to make a distinction to begin with between theory and philosophy. I take philosophy to mean a tradition, a sequence of texts and their teachings. Philosophy is what gets taught as philosophy. And I want to use theory for something else that can intersect with that. It's not either or. But I want to use theory as a term for something else, for something that arises out of situations more than out of institutions. Theory is the practice of forming and using concepts in situations that can also arise in everyday life. So what then is theory for the Anthropocene? It might be theory to be used in some fashion in a certain critical situation. Now, you can call this situation whatever you damn well like. Call it the Anthropocene, call it the Manthropocene, call it the Misanthropocene, the Cluthocene, call it the Capitalocene, call it the Metabolic Rift, my personal favorite. But, just call it something. And by calling it something, recognize that one is naming a situation that is in some ways unprecedented. That situation is one in which the sum total of social labor undermines our conditions of planetary existence. There is no longer an outside, a margin, and elsewhere to dump the waste products of that labor and pretend this disorder that we make has gone away. That disorder now feeds back through the whole metabolism of the planet. It has done so for a while, and it will keep doing so, in a sense, now forever. There is no environment or nature that is separate. There's no ecology that could be in balance if we just withdrew from it. So that's what I take, Metabolic Rift or Anthropocene to mean. Certain basic ways of knowing about such things necessarily come to us from the natural sciences. The best known example is carbon. pulling carbon out of the ground and putting it in the air changes the climate. That might be one of the key phenomena of the Anthropocene, but not the only one. But it's only through a vast apparatus, global in scope, of communication, computation, scientific cooperation, that we know that. Just as when Galileo declared in public that the Earth goes around the sun, or when Darwin and Wallace declared in public that all species, without exception, are the products of evolution, once again the natural sciences have something to tell us that challenges existing worldviews. So one aspect of theory for the Anthropocene, at least in my view, is to sort of reopen the question of relations to the natural sciences and how natural sciences interact with questions of power and culture and humanistic thought. Now, there is a sort of reflex action by which theory tries to claim a higher ground than the sciences. I personally don't find that a satisfactory starting point for a theory for the Anthropocene. We only know about the conditions of that ground in the first place from the natural sciences, in this case, earth sciences, rather than cosmology or biology. So maybe theory has to rethink its relation to ways of knowing that are not its own. I think we need to sort of refuse to compete for dominance with other forms of knowledge and figure out how to cooperate with them. Neither resenting the power of sciences nor pretending to a higher, more spiritual power is a way forward for theory in the current situation. But still, there's plenty to be done. There's worldviews to supersede and somehow replace. Our world is not just a heliocentric, evolving one. It's also one in which the world can no longer be treated as a thing apart, or an equilibrium, or a point of difference that can specify what's human. Our own actions are changing it, have changed it irrevocably, and in ways that undermine and cancel the conditions of possibility for this life. So we need other theories for other lives. My own thinking about this has been about the question of labor and its relation to nature and what counts as value. What if we define nature simply as that which labor encounters? How does cooperative labor, meshed as it is with a vast infrastructure and technical apparatus, present to us what is human as some knowledge and value about a non-human world, which is then mediated through an inhuman apparatus? All right, that sentence has got too many clauses. But to think about the human, an inhuman apparatus, and a non-human world as, if you like, three related pieces of the whole thing. Can that ensemble of labor and apparatus value the world differently? So that, I think, is the key question I want to draw out there. Now, I don't want to think about the Anthropocene from the point of view of capital. I mean, not that we can ignore it, right? But I want to think about it entirely from the point of view of capital. I think that leads to habits of thought in which capital is a kind of eternal and or powerful totality. And I find that a little disabling in the current situation. It also leads to the fantasy that if only it were possible to negate capital, then all our problems would be solved. This is manifestly untrue. Were capitalism to be abolished tomorrow? And let's hope we're still able to even imagine that, right? Let's just say it was abolished tomorrow. The Anthropocene will persist, and for thousands of years. We still have to face the problem of feeding and clothing and housing 7 billion people, not to mention doing triage on the multiplicity of webs of life that are in stress and in decline. In any case, it's clear that capitalism as a civilization is actually kind of already over, and it knows it. The ruling class of our time knows it can make no claim to rule for anyone but themselves. Hence their instinct to hide from us, to spy on us, to arm and fortify themselves, and to plunder and loot like there's no tomorrow, because there's no tomorrow. So we have to understand and process the feeling of living among the ruins. But the work of making another civilization has already begun. The next one will be a diminished one in some respects. But who knows? Who knows what the social body can do? If we understand that we are living in ruins, then we can understand that we do not have a philosophical tradition that we can simply continue as if it were whole and intact and passing through a homogeneous time. Rather, what we have are fragments not of a past, but of possible futures. Theory for the Anthropocene will be made from a patchwork of fragments repurposed for the current situation, one which will last far into the future. In fact, as far into the future as the Western tradition imagines it points back towards the past. The philosophers have only interpreted the Anthropocene. The point, however, to set a modest goal to start with, is to grasp how the Anthropocene has negated the possibility of merely continuing bodies of knowledge that we've inherited. So we might need to think about the structure of the production and teaching of knowledge itself as, if you like, a first and last order of business in the current situation. So that was my little opening riff, which I know may contain some provocations. We don't all have to agree on these things, but I wanted to open the floor first to Roy and then to Stephanie to briefly give us a different perspective to sort of triangulate this thing, and then we can talk about it together.
Well, thanks, Ken, for organizing this and for having us. It's really exciting conversation to be having, especially with so many people here. Thank you all for coming. Thanks to the New School for having us. I should mention that I'm, in addition to grappling with the philosophical quandary of the Anthropocene, I'm also struggling with a chest virus. So if I pass out,
it's metabolism all the way down.
Yeah, it's metabolism all the way down. So just in case I pass out, I want to begin with my closing remarks, which are that we're all going to die. But that's okay, because that was the case before global warming was an issue. That's just the human condition. And in certain ways, the Anthropocene brings that issue to the front of our consciousness in very dramatic and large-scale ways, which is sort of one of the points of my book. But that, you know, there are traditions, there are practices, there are ways of addressing that, the human condition problem, that we can integrate, turn back to, rely on. We don't have to make it all up out of whole cloth. But so, in responding to Ken's prompt and the topic at hand, I wanted to, rather than talk about the book, I wanted to sort of talk briefly about some of the key conceptual problems I see the Anthropocene giving rise to, and then talk about, you know, how I see we might begin to deal with those. And so I think of there being four key conceptual problems, and the first is the political ethical question. And we could formulate it different ways. In some ways, it's sort of the what Ken touched on is there's no outside, right? The issue of the universal human subject or species being or however we want to formulate it, that in a situation of universal danger arises, bringing with it the issue of differential capacities to respond. Right, so we have to rethink this, you know, concept of the human subject, and how we relate to each other politically. One of the problems conceptualizing the Anthropocene, conceptualizing climate change as a problem to deal with, is that there's no clear enemy. People have named. People always want to name. There's Exxon. Those bad things, and Shell, and so on. But you can't just point at oil companies without also pointing at the meat industry, without also pointing at all our cell phone and computer usage and the coal that gets burned to do that. The fact of the matter is that the problems are systemic. The problems are the responsibility of many, many people, industrialized countries. It's a global problem, and our complicity in it, and the possibility or impossibility of doing anything about it, is a profound conceptual problem. The second problem I see that Anthropocene giving rise to is the sort of existential problem, right? What does human life mean facing civilizational collapse or the possibility of human extinction, right? And how do we address that question in a way that that remains aware of the dangers of answering that question too vigorously, which is to say, it's not enough to simply, you know, say that we need to make a choice to face the void of existence, right? There has to be something more. So how do we participate in and construct meaningful systems of value in the face of, you know, basically the void, right? Not a new question, but one with a deeper urgency. The third problem, the third conceptual problem that the Anthropocene posing is, and Ken touched on this, is the surpassing of the human nature of binary. And people have talked about this in different ways. You know, maybe it's a sublation of this binary. We've gone beyond it. Maybe it's just no longer functions in the way that it did. I don't think we lose much by losing that binary. But it does seem clear in thinking about what it means to be locked into this total engagement with changing the climate and the feedback that that has on the Earth. The very idea of humans as a geological agent, right? The idea behind the Anthropocene puts us in a new relation to the Earth as the Earth. The distinction is gone. We humans are nature. Nature is humans. Some people have taken this to mean that human agency, human power, human technology has completely overtaken the globe, and now, you know, we can sort of, we're superhuman. But in fact, it could go just the other way. We could see this, the erasure of this distinction as a surrender, or as a descent of humanity, if we want to use that language, to pure determinism, where we're actually, where we see agency evacuated, right? If we are geology, then we're nothing more than just rocks. Which brings us to the fourth, and I think one of the most difficult questions, I think, that the Anthropocene poses, which is the question of agency. At an individual level, at a political level, at a conceptual philosophical level. You know, when you look at the history of the global organizations, the UN and so on, trying to deal with climate change, you know, and how it's a wicked problem with no good solutions, there seems to be a failure, right, of any kind of collective political potential there to actually rationally determine our course. And then there's the fact that we're all, you know, to return to the first problem, the fact that we're all complicit in, and we're all making choices that will lead to our own self-destruction. This seems to be a profound paradox. If we want to talk about human freedom, free will, agency, or liberation in meaningful ways, so what do we do about that? What do we do about these problems? These are conceptual problems that I see rising from the practical problems that climate change and the Anthropocene pose, which, you know, as we are all well aware of, civilizational collapse, rising seas, climate refugees, resource wars, increasing inequality of wealth, and increasingly militarized totalitarian states, heat waves, crazy storms like we're seeing in, like the one hitting Mexico right now. The question of what kinds of conceptual solutions we might put into effect requires us to ask, requires us to address the role and practice of philosophy, theory, conceptual thought, just as Ken was arguing. I have more to say, but I think I've hit my 5 minutes, and I don't want to keep going. So
we'll come back to this.
We'll come back, but I'll just pass it on. Okay.
Thank you. Thanks, Roy. Thanks, Ken. Thanks, New School, for having me. It's true, like Ken said, the three of us and probably everyone in this room, we're all coming from very different places and backgrounds, but I think what's important is that we're talking now within a common, which is our time. We're trying to understand our time, what we're living through, and the Anthropocene is a name for that in some way. A couple of years ago, to say we're living in the collapse of a civilization, to say that we're living in the end of a way of life, would sound crazy. You'd be a wingnut. Now, it's in the New York Times, you know? And I think that's something to take very seriously. But the weird thing about it, the end, the collapse, whatever, it's not a big punctual event. It's not something that stands right in front of us like a Fukushima or a Sandy that we can just point to and grasp. It's something that we inhabit that's slow. It's almost imperceptible in some ways at the corner of our eyes, like this. And so for that reason, it can be hard to get a handle on it, to make it make any sense. And so again, the Anthropocene, to me, it's a word for this. It's a way of giving a name to it and trying to sort of force that situation to become real for us. And then to begin figuring out what to do on that real ground. It's interesting, we say it's the end of a way of life, but the end, as many people have said throughout time, the end is also the beginning. So I think our time, the Anthropocene is marked by things like rising seas, climate change, all that, but also the revolutions that we've seen around the world in the last several years, the uprisings, as much as their impasses and their failures. I think all of this, these attempts to sort of break through the age, and then the forces that hold that back, I think it's all part of our time. So in my academic work, I've been studying sort of part of this time, which is the way in which a new sort of regime of resilience is being developed in New York City to try to govern the city in the face of future disturbances like climate change, rising seas, other Sandys, but also, social upheavals. It's interesting, if we look at this, what we see is that it's a new way of governing in some sense. It's a new set of techniques, technologies, and discourses that sort of really have lowered their horizon in some way. Instead of in the past when government would sort of promise this better future, things are going to change, you'll get refrigerators, now it's about survival. Resilience is about trying to maintain the city in the face of these disturbances. So what I'm studying are oyster reefs that are being built around Staten Island to try to attenuate storm surge. Not to stop it, not to change anything, but to just keep going through it. And that's sort of the model of resilience in general, just to keep going through it by any means necessary. And so, those oyster reefs are part of a much larger sort of expanding global apparatus that has, as much to do with Bakken oil fields and, building pipelines across North America, to keep going as it does with these sort of eco measures in the city. So I've been studying this, and we could say that, given the current state of things, that's the direction that we're going, continuation by any means necessary. But I think we have to think about the Anthropocene as sort of like a threshold moment, sort of a moment where things are uncertain. So while that looks like that's the dominant trajectory, I think we're sort of at a crossroads in some way, And what I've tried to take up in my own life with other people is trying to figure out how to open up that other path in some way, away from the disastrous line that just keeps going forever, going nowhere. The biggest thing has been the most important thing now is if we want to refuse sort of this kind of crisis government, this sort of resilient government that says there's nothing else, there's only surviving and continuing on, capitalism, liberal life, whatever. If we want to refuse that, it means that we have to figure out how to actually make other forms of life live now. Not in the future, not some other day, but now. So how to build habitable worlds, actual worlds that could go on beyond capitalism. That sort of means, I think, that the playing field is open, like Ken said. We have to make use of the world that we find ourselves in, which is not a pristine world. It's not, it's full of catastrophe, and it's toxic, So we can't operate according to some, you know, an abstract moral blueprint or a theory of how it should look. We can only start now and see what works. So that means figuring out things, you know, that might come to us from science, that might come to us from philosophy, that might come to us from engineering, whatever, you know, seeing how we can put them together with other people to start charting out that other path. I think it's really obvious that that's happening around the world already. People are taking up these questions in all kinds of ways, explicitly or not explicitly, you know? Everything from, again, like a Gezi Park, a Zuccotti Park, whatever, those kinds of places, to the millions of people who for some reason have gotten really into farming, because you don't make money from farming, so they're getting into it for some real reason, or people who CrossFit all day, you know? There's something in this that we should take seriously as a response to our time, right? So it's about, I think in these we see sort of an attempt to get back to a grip on life, to try to take life into to people's hands again and to go somewhere with that. I could say a lot more about that, but I'll leave it to the side. But in this sort of experimentation process that I think is redefining what it means to talk about revolution, I think we should try to not import the mentality of the governments that want to prevent that process, right? So by that I mean, I think we should not let ourselves be hostage to this sort of crisis mentality and this mentality that says there's nothing else, you should be happy to be surviving, and that you should just, you know, accept maybe a diminished kind of life. I think actually the real heart of our time and the real gamble is that in taking up this really fair, serious responsibility, it might be possible to actually discover a much fuller, richer kind of life than we ever knew existed back when maybe we didn't even see the catastrophe. You know, in taking that up, it might be possible. So we should keep that open against against nihilism. So I'll start there.
Thank you, Stephanie. I wanted to open with a question for both of you, which comes to me out of something that's in Roy's book, which has got to do with how one might now read certain traditions from the past. And you have a nice couple of pages I can't do justice to, that really kind of treats the tradition since the Greeks as a kind of living thing for a present situation. I wonder if you could expand on that just a little bit.
Yeah, well, so the idea is that I'm not quite sure where you're talking about, but so
the whole book really.
You know, the idea is that, you know, on one level, these are we have these conceptual tools that are alternatives to the way we live now. To capitalist life and so on. Because moving into the Anthropocene, we're going to need alternative ways of understanding our reality. And, you know, going back to Plato or Cicero or Montaigne or, you know, Chang Tzu or these other, you know, all kinds of traditions, you know, there are ways of understanding our relations to the world and to the finite limits of the world and to our mortality. Can give us a different option than the idea of progress or a utopian solution to not just, you know, whatever societal problem we're dealing with now, but sort of the human problem. Which there's no solution to, and there's you know, we've sort of, because of cheap carbon and so on, we've grown to believe that we can just fix everything. So there's that, but there's another way in that it works as well, which is, in a more, a Romantian sense, or in a sense that, you know, our language, the tools that we have now, all of it is condensed, concretized, living tradition from the past, from words like Anthropocene, you know, to ideas like capitalism or revolution. And those ideas and the humans that lived them, those dead, live in us through those ideas. And in the future, if the human species survives, it's up to us whether or not any of that continues to live into the future. And so that's sort of coming back to the role of theory or philosophy, what we're doing. That's the sort of, that's the imperative I see there, is for us to work to pass that.
It was Valerie who said in 1919, we later civilizations know we are mortal, which turned out not to be true. We just like forgot, but you know, that was a moment when that was really obvious, and we kind of forgot it all over again. And I just wondered, Stephanie, if you could just expand a little bit on your interest in not just the oyster beds, but farming, and the how those two sort of geographic ways of thinking about practice might connect up for you.
Okay. You know, another reason why I think the term Anthropocene is a really useful term is because I think completely unwittingly it gets at a way of understanding what's happened to us and what is this sort of world that we live in. What is capitalism? You know, in a deeper sense, it's not only economy. It's what it takes to make economy exist. So Anthropocene, the age of the human, a world oriented around the human. Okay, it gets at this. You know, and I think this is the heart of things. To make economy exist, you know, you have to separate people from everything. You have to separate the world into little pieces everywhere. People from other people. People from places, people from skills, knowledges, practices, you know, and then you kind of piece it back together with money. And so the reason why I think that things like the masses of people trying to take up farming again, or people trying to get in touch with their bodies again because our bodies have become like alien objects that we don't understand and that we just fear, you know, the reason why I think these things are sort of like of our time and responding to our time is because they, in some way, again, cognitively or not, take up this problematic, which is that we have no connection to our lives in some way. And so there are, in some sense, I think, you know, attempts to get back to that, to get back to the world in some way, and not back in time, but I mean, you know, to take up our existence and to get to know it again, to render it less alien. To us. I learned to do that by going to Governor's Island and going to the Harvard School a lot, where they teach people to do this, and they train you to build a cage, to put the cage in the water, to monitor them, and all this. And I went most recently like on a Saturday and Sunday. It's all day, each day, the last weekend of summer, to learn. I was like, oh God, you know, it's a long trip, you take a boat, no one's going to be there. It was like 40 or 50 people who had come out just to learn this, because they were passionate about oysters. And it's like this all the time with this stuff. And so it's like, everywhere you go, there's just this like desperation to get your hands wet, to get back to something, you know. So,
I wonder, you know, in most comradely fashion, you know, what would be the space where we disagree about stuff? You know, like where's the terrain where I suspect I'm kind of I'd put a bigger bet on a scientific technical apparatus than you guys would. Is that a reasonable assumption in terms of how we would think, you know, the bits we want to do are different in some sense? Would that be reasonable?
I'm all good with scientific technical apparatus. I think thinking empirically, with science is profoundly important. I mean, we wouldn't even know what was happening without that. So, yeah. I mean, I think there's one difference might be, I should let you answer the question, scientific technical apparatus. But I definitely don't think that there's revolutionary potential in the crisis we face. I think we're screwed, and it's really about dealing with that and learning to live with that.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
Just Well, I mean, on that, I think it's fundamental that it's our responsibility to fight as hard as we can at this moment in history. That's just it. But about science, I think it depends what we mean by science.
Of course, yeah.
So actually, I don't think it's true what you say. I think, you know, really, if we really take seriously out the possibility of building other ways of life that are capable of supporting human beings, plants, you know, all this, waters, making things live, making us able to go beyond, you know, an uprising or whatever, then we have to look at anything and everything and see what's possible, what we can use, what we can't use, what needs to be destroyed, what might have to be figured out. And this means really getting rid of that sort of screen, that screen of I don't know, you could call it morality, you could call it politics, I don't know what you could call it, but the screen between us and the world. And then starting to really work with it. You know, and about science in particular, you know, I'm actually an environmental scientist, so I think it's a really interesting field in general. But, you know, even Husserl, a long time ago, had a really nice diagnosis of science, and he said it's, you know, it's not the problem of science, it's that science has lost its life world. And so science can be done in different ways. It can emerge in different ways. So what's happened, in according to him, you know, is that science is out here and it's lost its origins, which are in actual worlds of people and places and experience. So I think if we do science that way, it's different.
I'll give you a whole awesome way to read the history of climate science is accidentally rediscovering it and not knowing it did it. Just occurs to me. There's like a paper you could get out of that.
That's kind of how I see it.
Yeah. Interesting. Yeah. All right, but I am from like steel and coal country. That like built the infrastructure that destroyed the planet, you know, that's what my people did. But I'm inclined to think we just built another one that would be even bigger, you know, is kind of how you get out of that. And I kind of suspect you guys wouldn't kind of quite feel it the same.
So you're saying we should build a bigger...
Bigger infrastructure.
The technosphere.
Yeah. I think you're going a different direction to that. And obviously, I'm doing this in a caricature way, just to get some contrast in the world, if you like.
Yeah. I think we have to ask ourselves, you know, why would you want to build that? Why would that make sense? And then I think we then would want to ask, okay, so is it because sometimes we find ourselves asking questions from a particular position where we imagine ourselves as solving a global problem? You know, we imagine ourselves out here and then a world that's a problem to be solved. So then it would be a question of 7 billion people on a planet and how... Am I, Stephanie Wakefield, here to, you know, solve that problem? Which, you know, it's a particular way of thinking about reality, and one that, you know, hasn't always been how people think. And so, you know, at the very least, I think we could stop in for a minute with that question and think about what it means and what it represents as a relation to reality.
I realize, of course, I misunderstood. So, yeah, in terms of techno-scientific solutions to climate change, I don't have any hope for that either. There are possibilities, I think, but I don't think we have time. I think we had time, you know, 30 years ago, 20 years ago even. But I think, just, you know, from what I hear from scientists and looking at reports and IPCC reports and everything, the political technologies that we're dealing with. I don't think we have time to make those infrastructural changes that would be required to actually handle the problem. Yeah.
I'm going to ask the audience for so think your question. I'm just going to get one more in, and then so think about what you want to ask our esteemed panelists here. I want to ask you, you know, what you think about what's good curriculum now? Like, just not necessarily in a school context, but like, what's a way to think about what knowledge is and should do?
No, go ahead. If you're ready.
I teach at Queen's College, amongst other places. I always assign Roy's article from the New York Times. It's really great, actually, for getting to the heart of things.
The book version's even better.
It's a really good place to start. Because then we begin from our reality, and then we start asking further questions. There's something that we're doing in December at Woodbine this is sort of related to this. It's going to be a climate inquiry, climate futures inquiry, and we're sort of timing it to coincide with the climate summit that's been happening in France in December, which will, you know, do what all of the summits do.
It'll be peak summit.
Yeah.
and the idea is sort of to take back science in a way, and to force what's happening to touch us. So it's public, and you know, anyone's invited to come. It's going to be a many-week sort of curriculum of study where we try to understand climate change, basically, and then projections for New York City, very specifically here, you know, 10-year, 50-year, 100-year, what we're already living through. And then actually kind of go around the city and go to places where this is really going to be happening already. And then sort of together work through it and try to draw some conclusions of our own. So in a sense, to try to see what we can do with science. And,
it's a great model.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, so curriculum. You know, I'm trained as a literary scholar. So, when I think about curriculum, I'm thinking about an English class, and you know, which isn't necessarily the best way into thinking about our current predicament, except
certainly not the worst.
Certainly not the worst either. And in fact, I'm teaching a course now on sort of literature and climate change. You know, and we're dealing with texts from the Epic of Gilgamesh to Blake's The Marriage of Good and Evil to The Grapes of Wrath to Ben Lerner's recent novel 1004. And then other stuff too. Butler's Parable of the Sower. You know, there's quite a lot of stuff there.
It's an awesome reading list, by the way.
It's a fun class. The kids are loving it, and I'm enjoying it. I mean, for me, you know.
But can I just ask, would you take a different question to Blake, if that's, for example, one of your examples there?
Would I take a different question to
Blake? Yeah, would you be sort of orienting people to read it differently?
You know, we're reading it in terms of, we're reading it thinking about lost worlds and new worlds. Mm-hmm. So how we deal with these transition moments. Mm-hmm. Because that's a little bit easier to find in the cultural record than specific sort of symptomatic readings of climate change, which you can find as well. Dealing with these enormous social changes. So Blake is wonderful for that. Also for posing the question of the relationship between the human and the natural, or the human and the supernatural. You know, The Marriage of Heaven and Hell is such a weird book. Mm. So those are some of the things that come up with that. For me, it's always, you know, I always want to go back to Spinoza on these things. And I also recently, while I was in the Arctic this summer, I read Claude Lévi-Strauss's Triste Tropique, which I've just been thinking about since,
a perfect book to take to the Arctic,
right?
Brazil,
that's
tropics.
That was the perversity for me. But so thinking about that book you know, his the idea of grief, the idea of mourning in that book, and then also the sort
he read some of it here at the New School too. I'm just going to claim it.
Right. No, absolutely. Yeah. But also the very interesting merging of sort of Buddhism and Marxism at the end of the book, I find very compelling and something that I want to think more about and put on a curriculum so I can get other people to think it with me.
Awesome. All right, so I'm going to ask folks in the audience, gentlemen with the pen.
Hi. Were I to give Roy's narrative to somebody in the pub in England, I'm very likely to have a response, cheer up, mate. It might never happen. Now, I mean, I think there's a real problem with the theory of the Anthropocene in terms of trying to think in ways that do not import into the social sciences or into the humanities forms of essentially Judeo-Christian eschatology, apocalypticism, forms of neo-Malthusian thought. And these, you know, that we have always been told in the Judeo-Christian tradition that this is the end time, that there are certain urgent tasks that arise from the fact that it's the end time. Now, it's quite clear. I'm not a climate change denier by any means. I hope you understand that. But it's quite clear that there are significant changes that have happened in the human environment, which humans have caused. They have been causing changes in the environment for a rather long period of time. And the question really then, it seems to me, for the Anthropocene is, what time are we in now? Indeed, what does time mean? what are the kinds of temporalities which we're actually dealing with? And I think that I'm a little bit resistant to some of the kind of ways in which this is translated into a kind of primacy, something that should have a primacy of attention. Because it seems to me that we have a whole range of human problems. Most human beings, climate change will be connected to problems of their survival over the very long term, but there are far more immediate problems of subsistence and of welfare, which in fact have their best solutions through forms of industrialization. And this is the point at which your Chinese and your Indian delegates, when they come to Paris, and they ask questions about, yes, we have a problem here, but how do we achieve the transformation of our societies from places in which people are living very, very close to death, into places which have the kind of abundance and plenty, places which have the leisure to worry about the extinction of particular kinds of animals or plants. I think that these are important kinds of issues for us to consider. To put it very succinctly, Christophe Bonnet in an essay this summer, he asked the question, who is the Anthropos that we're thinking of when we talk about the Anthropocene?
7 billion people. Yeah. I want to gather a few comments before we...
Oh, sure. Well, mine was it's a variant of the same question, so I'll make it very brief. We who, right? So you've made a lot of references to me. And I don't think there's a danger of our genus dying out, maybe our species, but not the genus. So I'm thinking there of Olaf Stapleton's Hegelian sci-fi from the 1930s, if you know it, right? And the second issue is, I'm attracted to the recuperation of sort of hobbyists getting back to the land in the global north, engaging in farming and beekeeping and so forth. But of course, that's most people aren't getting back to it, they're already in it. And when we're talking about the death of a civilization, we're not talking about, really, I don't think about the death of ours. I don't think Manhattan's gonna go anywhere, really. But everywhere else is gonna go someplace, and that's going to be enormously profitable for the us, right? Which I'm going to oppose to this sort of generalized we that you've been talking about.
A couple more up here.
Real quick, just to kind of augment that, for you guys to really talk about scale and scalability as in various ways you've been referring to issues of scale, and certainly industrialization versus hobbies is a question of scale and context. So to really kind of address that as not solutions, but very, very different sort of strategies of being, and whether those affect more than the we in New York or the we in countries aspiring to be the we in New York.
And there's one more. I'm just going to work this side, and then don't worry, other side. I'm going to come back to you.
Thank you. So I just wanted to comment that the discussion in the panel reflects a common phenomenon that I've been seeing in regards to discussing the theory of the Anthropocene, and that's a dichotomy between, well, recognizing this problem that we are afforded with this potential for an opportunity to improve and better our societies versus we're doomed and everything is, pretty much down the can. That comment aside, I just wanted to talk about that I heard capitalism mentioned a few times and kind of framed as a culprit in regards to the anthropogenic problems that we're dealing with, but to some extent, is it just capitalism? Is it not all economic systems? And to kind of balance that out, I mean, it's not just capitalists who industrialize, the rest of the world has, and is continuing to. So what implications does that have for the way we then choose to regulate our economic systems through the political systems we develop?
Okay, I want to give the panel a chance to have at some of that. And people would like to pass the microphone to the other side so they can have a shot, and then we'll go up the back of the room. Sorry, I'm doing it in quarters.
All right, well, I'll try to address all of that. I'll start with capitalism, because I don't think capitalism's the problem. We're not gonna, capitalism isn't heating up the planet. Capitalism isn't gonna melt the poles and melt all the methane and carbon locked in the permafrost. It's carbon, right? It's specifically fossil fueled capitalism that's the problem, that's been running on carbon for 200 years or so. that's been pumping carbon into the atmosphere, that's heating up the planet, that's causing the warming that's going to result in the kinds, you know, crazy storms and rising seas and desertification and drought and climate wars, climate refugees like we see, like we're seeing in Syria and Iraq today. You know, it's carbon that's the issue at a sort of material level. And in terms of scale, right, it affects, I'm not sure how to answer that question specifically, but it affects the whole planet. It's a problem that has, it's out of our control at this point. It's you know, I mean, I know there are people working on it, but so much of the global industrial infrastructure is built on burning carbon, and it would take us so long to change that global infrastructure. It would take us 15, 20 years at least if the nations of the world, 200 some odd nations of the world, were united in doing that, which isn't the case. It would still take 20 years, which I think is going to be too late, because there's already methane coming up out of, you know, off the Pacific coast, off the north coast of Russia. There's methane coming up out of the Siberian permafrost. I read another, you know, there's more reports coming out from scientists every day worried about the shockingly rapid melt of permafrost and the potential for methane release that poses. And that's just, I mean, and the methane release is like the big scary monster dragon that's going to superheat the planet. We don't even have to get there to deal with the, you know, the catastrophic impact from 2 degrees Celsius warming, not to speak of 3 degrees, 4 degrees, 6 degrees, which we're looking at with business as usual projections for industrialization into the coming decades. So that scale, and so who's the we? It's all of us. It's all 7 billion, and this is why I, you know, talked about how the Anthropocene poses this as a problem. It poses the problem of species being or a universal human subject in a new light, because it really does affect. It will affect everyone. There will be some people. There are people who have more access to resources, who will be able to protect themselves better, who will be able to leave storm-damaged areas, who will be able to recover storm-damaged areas. You know, and so that reflects us back into a sort of resource scarcity situation in which we need to consider how resources are distributed and what politics means in those terms. Yeah, so I think I answered everything. I may have left out temporality, but I'll get to it later.
I know what's there, right? Where do I want to start? Capitalism. I think it's not only capitalism, it's economy. There's a really good French Marxist guy called Jacques Fredin. I don't know if anyone's read him, but he's written a lot about this, about how it's not a question of a good economy, bad economy, but economy as a model of life. Economy as a way of relating to the world in which there are general equivalents that can unite things and make things measurable. So Soviet economy, you know, capitalist American economy, whatever. It's an economy. It's a model of life. And what he talks about a lot are these histories, you know, of what it takes to build that, to make that real in reality and not just an idea. So it takes primitive accumulation, obviously. It takes enclosures. It takes taking away people's land, you know, forcing people to go work in factories because they now have no other choice, so on and so forth. These are histories that are our histories. And that's where you start to realize, you know, we didn't probably do these things, you know, and you start to see that there isn't just a we, like an abstract we, you know, go to work for a wage. You know, that already tells you there's not a single we. And it's not going to be that way in the future either. I think we have to take that seriously. Bruno Latour, the sociologist who used to, you know, talk a lot about speed bumps and how speed bumps are like people and all this. Now he's saying, you know, the Anthropocene is a time of war. And we have to take that seriously. He said, currently, the only people who admit that are the ones who govern us and who want to continue the disaster. They're the ones organized for it. They're the ones who accept it. And then we're over here saying, oh, no. And so, you know, what he's called for, and I think he's right, is to say, is to take that up and to accept that. And that means getting organized again. You know, and about scale, I think this is something, I mean, obviously, things have to be big. We have to be expansive. We have to, I mean, when I think about, when I look around the world and I see examples of people building autonomy, people building territories, whether it's Chiapas, the Zapatistas there, who've been doing that for decades, or in Kurdistan, or the Mohawks upstate New York, or, you know, all these different places where people are building these things, they're doing it as networks. They're doing it as big, expansive constellations that aren't, they're not, you know, the idea of autonomy as some kind of self-sufficient little commune in a geodesic dome. You know, these are big, and they need to be much bigger. And they need to be able to connect with each other and help each other and form vast constellations somehow. But I think that's the future. And about time, it's really important. You know, in the past, a lot of people sort of understood the way that the world was governed in terms of sort of holding off, preventing the end, the catacomb, you know, this sort of thing, following an apocalyptic tradition. And a lot of revolutionary movements have imported that into their way of thinking. The revolution is something over there that'll happen one day, and at that point, the rivers will flow with lemonade. You know, that's an actual real example. You know, then things could be better, then we could live, then we could change things. You know, so it's very apocalyptic. It's apocalyptic has pervaded government as much as revolutionaries. But it's changed today, I think. And if we look at resilient government, it's pretty obvious. You know, instead of promising something behind the veil that, you know, at some point there'll be the, you know, salvation. At some point, you know, now behind the veil, there's nothing. Just more crisis. That's it. And, you know, then on the other hand, if we accept that, maybe something is revealed still in our time, which is that, you know, there's nothing to wait for. You know, there's no reason to adhere to the apocalyptic timeline anymore in thinking about revolution or life either. It's only something to begin now. And so then that means, I think, taking up the messianic tradition, which is hidden in or comes and goes in the apocalyptic, you know?
Can I just add two things in there? One, to come back to the question of temporality and sort of the apocalyptic. My point of view, or, you know, I think it's already happened. We're already in it. It's not going to happen. It's not something that, you know, we have to look forward to. We're already in it. It's already happening. This civilization's already dead. We're already in a post-climate change world. It's already happening. It's the world we live in now. So that's what I would say about that. And the other thing, because war was mentioned, and this Bruno Latour's interesting formulation of the Anthropocene as a time of war, or that we are in a war, and I think that's right, that it will be a time of war. It already is a time of war. I mentioned Iraq, Syria, there's Ukraine, there's Russia, there's Yemen, I mean, all over. And I'm very resistant to that kind of language, to thinking about it in that way. You know, because I think, you know, as we move from looking at it happening on a screen to situations where we're in it, you know, we'll face choices whether to aggress, whether to kill, or whether to learn to die, right? And, you know, once the killing starts, there's no way to tell how that's gonna end. And it just feeds on itself. War has its own logics, war has its own hungers, and I think we need to be very wary of calls for war in this time.
All right, I want to give this other half of the room a chance. Where did Mike go? All right, over there.
It sounds like we're talking about a way of consciousness, a positive, generative way of consciousness is what Stephanie seems to be expressing in farming and whatnot. And then versus that, it is always like this question of nihilism. So I think it's the question of what do we do with this mass cultural memory of what we as a species have done. Where should that go, and at what scale? Is it to art, or should it be just passively, watched away by just watching television or something? Is it something that should be suppressed? What? So I feel like, I think that's where it becomes like nihilism versus positive, generative, existence. But I don't think it needs to be versus. I think we need to establish some kinds of rituals in order to deal with, how we feel, because it is an actuality, that our species has done X.
Yeah, the affect question looms large, I think. Mm-hmm. And, I don't know that you have to choose. I mean, if you're talking to people who are from a religious tradition, it makes sense to try to explain things in a language that people understand. I'm from a very secular tradition, that really doesn't work for me. So I don't need it explained to me in those terms. I need it explained in some other terms. So it's not really either or. It's how you process through all the cultural systems that are available. But I like that question of ritual, and I'm really not sure what that would be at the moment. But that would be an interesting thought. What would be the opposite of Burning Man, which is, you could see, is the great invention of the way to signify the end, in a way. So just burn a whole lot of stuff, accelerate it. It's like, what we do that's the opposite of that. That's a great cultural question. So I didn't mean to do that, but anyway. Let's get a few more thoughts, and then I'll wait.
I actually had a question about some of the specific examples of sort of like cultural effects of this awareness that we are entering into this era of collapse. So examples like, I think Steph used like political uprisings and exercise fads and that kind of stuff. And I think Roy mentioned resource wars and ecological refugees. But I think of those things as things that have existed for some time. And all wars would be resource wars. Many refugees would be ecological refugees. Exercise fads have been around for a few hundred years. So I wonder what for you are the markers that make those examples that you're giving something new, something that's really obviously about the Anthropocene.
And let's let the mic wander a little bit and see if you've got any other thoughts together.
This is a rather huge question, so I don't know how you
as opposed to all these other ones.
much more vague than the others. But Kelly Oliver has an interesting book on the distinction, new book on the old distinction between Earth and the world. And those seem to be interchangeable in all the discussions, and that's very common. But I know that you're thinking specifically sometimes in terms of Earth and sometimes in terms of the world, or just if you had any thoughts about that, whether that's a useful distinction.
Yeah, it's a good point. The world that climate science models is an incredibly abstract one. And but I think Stephanie was already raising, I think, the question of how that's lived, how that connects to Earth's as experience. I think it'd be a very important question. Yep. All right, give our panel a shot. Oh yeah, we got somebody over here. Let's go back over to the back of the room on the other side.
Hi. Okay, so I'm going to try and piece this together as best as I can. I've already written something beforehand. But so I am more sympathetic to Roy, I think, out of all three of you. Insofar as that I don't see the Anthropocene necessarily posing new problems. And I'm really skeptical of the grandiose kind of language that surrounds it. I think it's very, very, okay, well, So what I have in mind, for instance, is there's very much a critique of the Enlightenment at work here, but didn't this already happen, for instance, with Walter Benjamin and Adorno, and this, you didn't even need atomic bombs at the time to think about civilizational collapse. And we don't even need global warming to think about civilizational collapse. I think it's just like a hot topic. You know, there's market collapse, there's migrant crises, things like this. And for Benjamin, it's a permanent state of emergency. It's not, oh, here's this thing that's gonna happen to us, let's react to it, you know, either melancholically or you know, courageously. It's a permanent, you know, there's permanently a state of crisis, and it's not just a crisis to others, it's, you know, it's a crisis to ourselves as well. And this is maybe another way of thinking, if I have to have a kind of concise question, it would be this, is in thinking about the Anthropocene, it seems as though we're kind of pushing aside a whole bunch of existential dynamics, which I think what is Roy more or less gesturing towards. We're thinking about, you know, new forms of collective agency, et cetera, et cetera. But are we really doing that at the expense of kind of flattening our image of what it means to be human? And the real crises, which are, you know, crises of modernity and nihilism and things like this. But, okay, I'll leave it.
Well, I wonder if we're like working through the stages of like, Anthropocene's not a thing. And then the next stage is, yeah, Anthropocene's a thing, but we already knew that already. And maybe we're at that stage. I mean, it's in the logic of the argument that this thing's been going on at least since the Industrial Revolution. Jason Moore would take us back to, you know, the 1400s as really the beginning of commodification or economies' need for a surplus nature in order to fuel circuits of reproduction. It needed a gift from outside. And we ran out of the gift, is what I'm saying. But I say, I can't find the page in Walter Benjamin where he understands climate. I have never found that page. Alexander Bogdanov did, and so I've made a case for why he matters. There are a couple of others you could put on the list, but generally pretty much nobody makes the case, and no one's got a really sound relationship between carbon and climate, really till mid to late 20th century. So, you know, we're not dealing with fairly new ideas, I think.
But I mean, I'm just skeptical about treating these issues in isolation. And to be a philosopher as opposed to being like an instrumental theorist is to try and take them as you know, symptomatic and systematic, as Roy was really trying to stress, which is, I tend to think that, yeah, Walter Benjamin was talking about the climate, and of course I'm not upholding Benjamin as, I mean, Benjamin's not like my go-to person. I think that the phrase, a permanent state of emergency, draws a good contrast here as opposed to us trying to think. Because, I mean, it's almost as though the Anthropocene for us is that it's a crisis because we are, you know, deep bourgeois academics, and this is, you know, finally threatening us. Whereas, you know, no, this is like, we live in a time of constant crisis. And there's all sorts of kind of internal dynamics that just seem to be completely eclipsed insofar as we're talking about some future catastrophe. Okay, I'll leave it.
Okay, well, petite bourgeois academics, speak for yourself.
I don't mean it, I'm not talking, I don't think you are the culprits.
I'm just joking. Yeah. Okay, so
I was
described
as a bourgeois academic. full thing.
If only. Okay,
because
so,
I have tenure.
So I think, you know, we could perfectly well say nihilism is what we're living in, if you wanted to, you know, get at this, I mean, in certain ways. But, you know, and people, Nietzsche, you know, Heidegger, others, tried to understand our time, tried to understand this thing we could call nihilism, we could call the end of metaphysics, we could call a lot of things. They tried to understand it. People have tried to understand it in different ways, you know, but our time is a bit different. You know, while they talked about the end of all values, the end of all meaning in that rubric, they could be sure of certain things. You know, they wanted to get rid of grounds, but they knew the ground under their feet would be there. We in New York cannot say that. New York, parts of New York will be underwater in our lifetimes. We have to take that seriously. That's just a fact. So, but Nietzsche has a really great way of describing nihilism. And by nihilism, he means sort of this historical moment that we're in, this historical time. He said, you know, nihilism is a time when all the old ways of trying to stamp value, stamp meaning on existence, no longer held. People don't believe in them anymore. You know, God is dead, now man is dead, mm-hmm. Anthropocene. And here we are. But that wasn't the end of it. The end of it was that, yeah, those things don't hold anymore, and yet we are unable or unwilling or afraid to create new forms of meaning for ourselves according to a different logic of where meaning comes from. You know, instead of stamping it on being, creating it for ourselves with other people in other places, you know. So we're unwilling to do that, we're unable to do that. So we're caught. And that caughtness is nihilism. You know, and I think we could definitely say that we're there. We're really in that. And so I think one of the keys is trying to just accept that we're going to have to create sense now for ourselves. New forms of value, not capitalist value, not things that are measurable that link everything, you know, not, you know, forms that tell the whole planet what to do, but meaning, meaningful life, what does it mean? You know, and this comes up very much in relation to the question of death and mortality, not death, mortality. When you recognize your mortality, you can have different responses. One of them could be to obsess about it, like, oh my God, we're dying, I'm dying, this is it, it's horrible, and just spend your whole life worrying and trying to prevent it and avoid it, which is one way of responding to our time. Or you could say, all right, I have one life between birth and death. I have to make it meaningful, you know? And I think that's another way of responding to our time at a collective level and individual level. The one thing about farming and whatnot that you said, I just want to be really, really clear. I threw that example out there, but hackers too, everything. Okay, so I want to be really, really clear that I'm not suggesting there's anything precious that we should go back to. We're here now. Capitalism happened. There's no way to go back, nor is it desirable. You know, I don't know where we think we are, if not here now. You know, and so we have to begin from that world. And so when I mentioned this, these people, like lots of people going to learn farming again, like leaving New York City, the frantic life of New York City, to go upstate and live in the Catskills and farm, I only mentioned that as one symptom amongst many, many, which would include hackers. Hackers demanding, we have a right to know how it works, you know, or makers or whatever, who are doing 3D printing. These are all symptoms in some way, I think, and I'm just bringing up as an example of that, symptoms of our time. So.
All right, well, so I'm gonna, yeah. What I've got on here, like nihilism, cultural examples, earth world, and permanent crisis, a real crisis, whatever. So I'm gonna try to address all of that, but I'm gonna go in reverse order. Dealing with the question of, you know, whether or not the Anthropocene is something new or it just reconfigures old problems, you know, I don't think that's a helpful binarism. I think it's both. I think it is a substantially new configuration of old problems. And part of how I think we can understand it is by going to this earth, maybe thinking about it through the earth world distinction. The earth is changing. It's, you know, it was in one climate system for 11,000 years or whatever, and it is changing because of this radical experiment we've worked on it, dumping all this carbon into it. It's changing in ways that we do not understand. We don't understand how they're gonna turn out. We have, you know, there are good models, there's historical evidence to show us what's gonna happen, but it's an experiment, the likes of which has never been worked on the Earth. So that's, the Earth we live on is changing, and our worlds are not changing fast enough to keep up. And that differential is going to grow more and more extreme. We're going to more and more, I think, face the fact that the Earth is changing faster than we can keep up with our comprehensions of it. I mean, you know, even before this, the Anthropocene, you know, recent technological innovations pose this problem. William Gibson famously said that, you know, most of us live, you know, 6 to 10 years in the past, in our heads, right? Because of the advances in technology. Well, the same sort of thing is happening with the global climate.
we live in our worlds in the past, but the earth is changing. And this goes to the question of cultural examples and how, you know, what the markers are for making sense of the situation. It's, you know, it's interesting to look at. I'm sort of a materialist, I guess. You know, for me, culture creates, you know, imaginary solutions to real problems, or, you know, it's massaging things. And of course, it's a complicated dialectical relationship that we wouldn't get to the bottom of if we sat here for 600 years. But, you know, I cite examples like Syria and Ukraine because those are wars that are connected to droughts, that are connected to climate change. Syria specifically has been having a drought since 2006 that's connected to long-term changes in the climate that are likely driven by climate change. So that's why I use that example. Ukraine's been having a drought. You know, California's having a drought. You know, the examples I pick aren't just relevant because they speak to how we're dealing with climate change, but they're relevant to me because they point to, you know, empirical phenomena that have, you know, there's a strong case to be made for causal relationships. So, you know, what do we do, or how do we understand that, or how do we respond as cultural producers of whatever intellectual stripe? You know, I don't think nihilism is it's not what I'm offering. It's not what I, because for me, what that means is, you know, the Nietzsche comes up there, you know, mankind would rather will nothing than not will. And I don't, you know, I'm not advocating that we will nothing, or will nothingness. What I am arguing for is the tarrying with the negative, is interrupting our circuits of reaction and response, is, you know, developing a consciousness that learns to accept the possibility of nothingness, learns to accept the possibility of finitude, mortality, and ending, in order to make more aware, more conscious, more ethical choices in this, you know, in this little moment we have, you know, and this is where I think where I can come back and sort of, you know, join forces with Stephanie, and I do think we should fight. I don't want to use that language of fighting and war, but I do think we need to work for a better world, work for better connections, resilient, small scale, local alternative possibilities, just without any hope of ever succeeding. You know, we need to do the work without ever hoping that it will ever fix things.
Can I say something? Which is how peasants have fought for centuries, but not us models.
There's a very well known Italian feminist from the Autonomia movement, Mariosa Della Costa, who in the 1970s was a big part of all the sort of upheavals there and organizing there. And she said something in a sort of autobiographical talk she gave that really, really sticks with me a lot. She said, "I look back on my time in Autonomia, and I don't remember ever having a single moment, almost, of joy. I remember only a complete and utter exhaustion." And I think, somehow related to what you were saying, as we try to respond to our time in a way that would be adequate, whatever that means, should think about how we do it. And try not to be sort of, like I said before, like hostage to this regime that always wants to make us frantic. That is New York City par excellence. you're exhausted. Everyone in this room is like, I don't even say anything else, you know? So to actually develop ways, maybe it has to do with rituals partially, ways, forms, disciplines, practices that make it so that we can not be hostage to that.
We say pessimism of the intellect, optimism of the will. Actually, Romain Rolland, not Gramsci, gets a credit for it. Maybe it's not a satisfactory formulation anymore. So maybe a little bit of both. Now, is there anything we've not addressed? Yeah, Stephanie in front here.
Yeah.
Wait till the mic comes back to you. Now, I don't want to keep us too long. I'm just going to get a couple of more thoughts. And I have someone behind you must get something in. Where did the mic go?
I have.
Oh, you have it. And then give it to Stephanie in front of you after you. Yeah, thank you.
Just a short one, both for Stephanie and for Roy. So for Stephanie first, I guess I had wanted you to talk about autonomy more. You've addressed it kind of briefly. But I think when Mackenzie was asking you before about possible the differences in both forms of political struggle between you, I don't want to sort of totally caricature either of your positions, but I don't know, in my sort of involvement with my autonomy has been described around indigenous sovereignty struggles and land rights struggles. Whereas, at least from what I glean from your work, and it's more this form of sort of global cybernetic governance. Those are very, very opposing schemes of what sort of constructive political struggle would look like, and I was wondering if you guys would sort of address that, was sort of brought up implicitly. And then even for Roy, sort of listening to you talk, bringing to mind a specific quote from the work of Ray Brassier from his book Nile Unbound. I don't want to talk about the book specifically for its work. He's distanced himself from it a bit recently. But the quote, thinking his interests that are different from those of the living, I wonder if that means anything to you, if you have anything to respond to it.
I mean, one way of thinking about modern infrastructure is it was little networks of big things, and like, you know, think the sublime of some dam or a factory in your head, you know? But maybe now it's a question of thinking big networks of little things. So I don't think the scale thing quite works you know, in the same way that we used to think it. But I'm more interested in the network part than the node part, if you like. So there could be a difference of orientation and so forth. The men in my family have been engineers since the 18th century. And then since my father, we fell off the path. But he was an architect, and now I just teach technology studies, you know. But I'm kind of oriented to that way of thinking a little bit. But I think we sort of established at the get-go that you need all of these ways of kinds of labor to fit together. I don't think it's an either-or thing, even though certain critiques of that way of thinking are valid, and I accept them and so forth, but it has certain affordances and so on. So it's trying to not have certain non-productive conversations about that strikes me as important. Should we write Brassia?
Oh, I thought we were going to get another.
I'm sorry. Yes, Stephanie, I meant to.
That's okay.
Get that in first.
I have a question.
I keep having thoughts.
How do you enculturate a society that's been weaned on instant gratification and reward to accept non-reward and long-term thinking around these ideas?
That's a good one. Oh, let's get one more, because that was so wonderfully brief. Yeah.
I think I would relate to that in the sense that if there's something that can be changed, in this case we're talking about changing human behavior, and so that then raises questions about humans being like rocks. I mean, I don't think there's confusion about humans being rocks, but the idea of, like, conceptually, what rights do humans have to be how they individually would want to be? I think that gets back to a lot of bigger issues. And then just with the notion around indigenous peoples, there's, you know, thought that the apocalypse indigenous people aren't not just in, it happened and is done, and
yeah.
It's who's left.
Yeah.
So that's kind of an interesting, it's interesting what's going on.
Mm-hmm. I think that's an important point, yeah. That in a sense it happened in my country, it happened 200 years ago in Australia with so-called settlement, also known as invasion. And so this is a last echo of that. Important point. I have a gentleman at the back, and I think that'll be our last contribution. try to sum up, and then we got more wine than those three bottles, but we're going to need it.
Since a political trump card, you read in George Orwell, and you lived in America, is putting the country on a war footing, if not a real war or a pseudo war. That is a kind of an emergency mentality that can go on for years. And Trump's theoretical, sensitive, social thinking, and I've noticed that. I'm getting old enough where I can notice that. And everybody uses it. You don't have to be a Republican or a Democrat. It's just something that you can use, and it seems to always work. And that's a very complicated thing to solve.
Well, ironically, if you need even some kind of resilient reaction to climate disruption in the United States, you need the military to do it because it's half of the state in terms of the budget. I didn't want to lose track of this question about reenculturation, though. But just one little bit on that is, I think there's a kind of Anthropocene unconscious in the whole of popular culture. I think that movie The Martian is all about the Anthropocene. It's just so much easier to think about it if it's on Mars. And one could criticize the sort of solutionism and the individualism and the fact that it's an American white guy that solves problems. But there's this sort of acknowledgement that there's a struggle just for human endurance and possibility in that space. The movie Gravity is the same, but it reverses the architecture of its above rather than below and all sort of stuff. But you can sort of work back through popular cinema, and like a lot of it is I think, now. And it's a sense in which it's not new. We've thought unconsciously about this for a long time. But it's a question of bringing that out and making people think through what's already there in popular culture.
Well, so I'll go first this time. And I'll just start with, Walking Dead. I walked down the connecting tunnel here, and there's skull, death. It's really kind of creeping me out. The new James Bond film, Spectre, whatever. Game of Thrones is a way of thinking about. There's all these ways that we're thinking about in the popular culture, but they don't address this question of different of changing. I mean, changing the whole of society or changing human behavior. I think these are goals that are beyond our capacities. I think one of the things we need to come to terms with is that we're limited and we can't. There have been many programs to reprogram the human being, and for better and for worse, we escape from that. We fall out of that. And so I don't think there's a way to fix how everybody thinks so that we all learn to, control our desires better and not want the things we want and not compete socially for attention and money and whatever. I think we can do it individually. I think we can do it in small groups. And that's what I think we can do. And so I guess that addresses the changing human behavior question. Humans are just like, we're a crazy species, and we've just, from the beginning, we've just extract resources and move on. Like, we're like nomad hunter killers, and we've done this all over the planet. And now we've done it to the planet. If we move on to Mars or what have you, I don't think we're gonna escape. But
we turn Mars into a car park.
And I guess last the. It sent a chill through my spine that you actually used the term Trump card. Because I don't think it's crazy to think that that's what we're looking at in the next decade. here in the United States, we've seen it happen, not just in our lifetimes, like we saw it happen, you know, 14 years ago. And we'll see, you know, again, war, we're seeing it happen. It's not like in the future, like already, Syria, Russia, all this stuff, ISIS. Like it's already happening. It's already being drummed up, right? We already live it. So, you know, we have to figure out how we relate to that kind of language of crisis and war. We have to figure out whether or not we try to incorporate it or resist it or reinterpret it or interrupt it or hopefully, at the very least, become more conscious of it.
Stephanie.
Just real quick. I think we just have to recognize what a diminished conception of human existence we've been given for much of our lives, and how much that is what liberalism is, or, you know, the Western capitalism, whatever it is that we live. We really have a very little idea of what we're capable of what human life could be, what it could become. I think this is part of why, honestly, The Walking Dead is the most popular TV show in America, watched by so many people, and all these apocalypse movies are so popular. We're dreaming this other way of life constantly, every week, every Sunday at 10 p.m. You watch people who, yeah, there's zombies, whatever, that's not the point. What's happening is that they're experiencing another life that they couldn't have lived before, discovering what they're capable of in that, and I think this is something that many people identify with for very real reasons. And so in terms of how, to change ourselves or, you know, something like this, I think it's something that it comes in practice. And, you know, in practice and in doing these things and being in the real world and working with people, you know, actually addressing these questions, you realize you're capable of so much more than you were told. You know? And I think that's, so about autonomy, I think that's what's going on around the world under this sort of word, this vague word that's being redefined in practice right now, autonomy. You see people everywhere saying, you know, I think you're done governing us because you haven't done a very good job. Look at this mess, you know? And people taking up their own existence, again, in different ways, completely differently according to their needs, their histories, the places that they're in, you know? So Kurdistan is certainly very different from Anwar upstate, you know? It's very different. But there's maybe a guiding thread, which is people sort of starting to together figure out what they're capable of and sort of build worlds themselves. And so I think that's sort of where autonomy is happening and being redefined in real practice today.
And on another upbeat note, we have wine. So I would like to thank everybody for coming, and our panelists, Roy and Stephanie, for joining me in conversation. There's books over in that corner, there'll be wine over in that corner, and drink and be merry for tomorrow.